Oh my gosh. Wizardman, tonight you bring up a very good point. I could spend my dad on guacamole. Oh, I said don't spend your father's. Don't spend your daddy's. But if it's for guacamole... that's tough. That is really tough. You know what? I don't even want to think about... We're done with guacamole. Because we've got something that is even better than guacamole. Our first GM for today. Honestly, I'm really glad that he's back. You know, he was here every now and then during the last... tournament, but definitely was a little bit more hiding in the shadows, lurking, and whenever he popped out, we were like, ah! Please, everybody, scream as Dana comes on in. Dana! Dana, I want to talk to you. Dana! Hello there, Dana! Dana, you're muted.
I'm muted. Hi. What?
You're not muted anymore. Hello.
How are you today?
Oh my gosh, I am doing great, and I'm super excited for what we've got today because you just hit me right in the childhood with this game.
I saw this recently. Well, I didn't see the original thing this came from. I saw this wonderful game we're about to play.
Oh recently. Yeah.
And I was like, you know, I need to give this out right away. And so we're going to do that. We're going to have something that, you know, that whole license-a-thon thing might be really interested in a bit later.
Oh, yeah, everybody. Before we show the game, remember license-a-thon, speedrun marathon for licensed game submissions are open. Go to licenseathon.live and you can sign up for that if you would like. Feel free to do that. So Dana, what licensed possibly game do we have today?
Today we're gonna get a quality sequel to a movie. We're getting The Neverending Story 2. Should have ended with the first one.
Oh, yeah. Neverending Story 2. Now, what platform is this one going to be on?
This is for the Amiga. While there are ports all over the place, there was a Commodore 64 one, and there was a DOS one, and there was even a ZX Spectrum. ZX. You know.
Yeah, Zs are Zs. ZZZ. Yeah.
But I gave him this version because it looked the nicest. It was a toss-up between this and the C64, so I could listen to Sid Tunes. But this one works out better later on if they can get out of state. I hope they get out of state.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
There's no guarantees.
I'm just remembering, you know, I watched The Neverending Story 2 when I was a kid, and I don't really remember anything except bubbles. Are there bubbles in this game?
I don't remember any bubbles in this game.
Were they bubbles or orbs? I think there were children trapped in bubbles, or maybe living bubbles.
No, I don't remember that part. At all. I barely remember this movie. I remember watching it. I remember being incredibly disappointed in it. But that's about it.
Okay. So I'm just trying to get the players to go live with their streams because this is going to be a fun video game. Amiga is always a reel and a half to capture. Thank you, Dana.
Yeah, because... they don't really like to use the whole screen. Ever.
Yeah.
But...
I mean, I'll live. Okay. I'll do it for you, Dana. Do it for you.
Look, this one actually, like, I had a record time on getting people set up. Everybody was up and running in, like, 5 minutes.
Dana, that never happens with your games.
I'm terrified everything's gonna fall apart because it's me.
Yeah, Same here. I was like, well, I'm glad that we have a full hour before we're going live and that Dana's giving away the game ASAP. But, you know,
right?
I'm going to go ahead and say Corndan put a lot of work into making sure things in RetroArch worked as well as possible. And even though we still run into some problems every now and then, it is so much better than it used to be.
Yeah, I mean, this is Amiga, and it's a drag and drop the file into RetroArch.
Compared
to what I had to do to get Weird Dreams working back in the day.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, right?
And then all it was buzz for about an hour.
Yeah, we had to jump to DOS version because, like, two people just straight couldn't run Amiga stuff for some reason. It was...
Technical nightmares.
Follow me.
We generally like the games to be the nightmares and not the setup, so I'm glad that we are able to get things going pretty well these days. Not always, but a lot more than before. So Dana, I want to know, what games have you been playing lately? Anything really fun or cool?
I mean, I've been playing Loop Hero because Loop Hero.
Yeah, that game's awesome.
Because the game's awesome. And very Amiga-esque in its graphics.
You know, I didn't think about that, but you're completely right.
Yeah, the design-wise, it's very the palette is very Commodore 64 to Amiga colors, and the resolution is more of an Amiga-style resolution because C64 was 8-bit; it didn't get that good. Not usually, anyway.
Yeah.
But no, it's very, very nice retro for me.
Well, cool. So I'm just kicking back a little bit, waiting for all of the players to go live, and I think that we have them all live.
Let's see, because... I've got... Oh, I hear music. Oh, that's... I've got...
Oh my gosh, itchy and scratchy music on my stream. I'm sorry that you have inferior never-ending story music.
Look, the never-ending story movie theme is a classic that everyone will get stuck in their head as soon as they hear it on the screen. Because...
What? Okay, I'm just looking at this and whatever, I'll capture. I have no idea how it's going to end up looking, but I'm impatient. Rawr!
Let's see. What else?
And I'm going to have to recapture everything anyway. Like.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, because thank you, Dana. Thank you for making my life a wonderful mess of Amiga. You know what? If there's anybody I have to thank for that, I'm glad that it can be you.
Well, thank you.
For better, for worse. Till death do us part, please, death. Make this story end.
Unfortunately, it really doesn't. It just doesn't.
I mean, it could.
No.
Oh, I
never.
Could.
Never.
Maybe always. It always is over. It's just done. No more stories. Everybody, you thought that the stories were going on forever, but no. No, we're going to... Goodbye.
Right there.
You know, the series did end. Like, it was absolutely a lie.
There apparently was a third one? I don't remember that at all.
I think there was, yeah, but I'm pretty sure that was the last of them. I hope that was the last of them.
Yeah, that's what I hear. Jack Black was in the third one, and
wait,
I...
what?
Yeah.
What kind of monstrosity are you talking about now? Yes. There was a cartoon?
Yeah.
Okay, look, I didn't want to vomit this morning, but I might just have to. Oh my gosh, the music.
You're right?
I love it. Okay, so I loved it. It got a little weird.
It's fine.
Everybody, welcome to the fine literature that we have for you today, the NeverEnding Story 2.
I forgot. Who did you pick for audio, Smebble?
Smebble is doing our audio, yes. Here are our players, Derby Ghost, Commander Rab, Smebble Bear, and Mecha Link. Now, we're going to go ahead and get a poll up. I'm going to run that for about 5 minutes, everybody. 5 minutes. By the way, I love that we can run it for about 5 minutes, and it doesn't really matter because it's not until the end where it's decided. Lord Dalek, thank you for those bits. Tempestral for the resub and for all the follows and hosting. So let's go ahead and do that. Will somebody on the left or somebody on the right win today? Starting the prediction now. Bam!
Yeah. I can't predict because I'm a mod. We can't vote.
You sure can't.
My prediction is that I win. Because I gave this out, and I get to watch all these.
I think I already won.
Yeah, I'm right?
Yeah. Oh my gosh, I need to put this into the Kuso playlist for music. Like, this is good. Oh my gosh.
Unfortunately, while the C64 version has a really nice stage one tune, it's not as good in the Amiga version.
Now, Dana, we do need emote spam.
Dragons.
Okay, dragons. Anything dragon or fantasy related. Because we're starting the countdown. As soon as I see movement in the first stage, I will start our timer.
Ah, Temp is in chat. I gave this to Temp, and Temp was very unhappy with it.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Wow, there's a lot of story. It is never ending.
You're going to see more of this
gosh.
Book, hopefully.
Okay. Hopefully. Well, okay.
So here's a video game. This is an action arcade video game.
Fun.
Like I said, the music is kind of on this first stage. It gets much better in the later stages.
Da 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 da. I do like that Tempestral is saying that. They thought this was a nuke pick, and you know what? Why not start with a nuke?
I had reasons to be here today. One of the racers being somebody I've known since I was like 16.
And
you
really?
Know I'm old, so I felt justified in punishing him for knowing of my existence.
You're like, you're my friend, time to die.
Yeah, something like that.
The evil cackle, I love it. That's what I dig.
So
you know what?
This game starts with a door maze.
Oh, like all good mazes, video right? games. No, I hate them. They're dumb. They really don't need to exist. You know what? So, I'm gonna go ahead and call this fine for cropping. Maybe I'll crop a little bit more, but I hate like trying to deal with this.
I'll look at it. Yeah, that's good enough. You're probably not going to get much better out of it.
Thank you, Amiga. Yeah, this music is like super mediocre, let me tell you.
Yeah, it's just kind of there. The Sid tune was so much better for level one, and I'm kind of upset they didn't have the same soundtrack, but a later stage in the Commodore version doesn't have any music at all, so and this one looks nicer because it's 16-bit.
Oh, I like the fire sound, that's good.
Also, You can watch people, you can watch the land disintegrate as they die.
Yeah! Dissolve the humans. See, that's what the villains probably wanted.
So, I gave them a nice hint.
Sure you did.
Sort of. And so far, only Smebble has gotten anywhere.
Okay.
I told them that if no one gets out of stage one, which I could see as a possibility, that the score would be the determining factor, because since this is the door maid, progress would be kind of a pain to judge otherwise.
Yeah. My guess is that score actually helps you see progression. Oh, Smebble Bear is unhappy. Fantasia needs you.
Score, there's only one way to get score in the first level, and that is by killing these giants, which Smebble has accidentally done twice.
Ah.
As soon as people figure out how that killing them is actually possible, the progression gets a lot easier.
How do you kill them? How do you kill a giant?
You push them off.
Push them off what?
Whatever, when they walk up to a ledge, you just walk up behind them and give them a shove.
Oh, okay. Well, that's not too hard. I could do that.
The problem here is that they are already conditioned to not touch them, because that's instant death.
You have to
come up to them from behind and push them off.
Yeah, the thing is, Derby Ghost is typing in the Discord chat right now saying there's a lot to test while you're playing this. And yeah, I would definitely agree. Trial and error. The thing is, if you don't take risks early on, you're not going to want to take risks later on. And that can be extremely detrimental. So, yeah, they're already saying that this is certainly a game, and what is, like, obviously there's the dumbness of having to push the giants off the cliff. What else are they going to be struggling with for a while?
Well, so there's actually two ways, and Smebble figured this out because, well, maybe figured it out. If you come up to a ledge and there's a giant on the other side, they enrage and charge you, and they'll fall themselves off.
Oh, you can just pull the jukes.
So that'll be super important for getting across a few ledges by tricking them into the pits.
So what are the dots at the bottom of the screen?
That's a timer.
Okay. Well, I don't like that.
And I'll point out that in the long play of the timer, it gets down to 4 ticks before the long play gets through the stage.
Oh, no. Oh, Smebble into the pit. Fantasia needs you! So whenever we see that screen, that is a death.
This is both a straightforward door maze and not really at all, because it doesn't really make sense where it comes out, but everything's kind of laid out so you can walk in a straight line as long as you know which doors to go in.
Okay.
There's no real weird shuffling going on. So if you worked at it enough and you got rid of giant...
Derby got pincered! I love it.
So if you figure out how to kill the giants and just take your time and map it out, you probably won't get through it on the first try because of the timer. But after you've done a bit of figuring out where everything goes, you'll get through it.
Is there any information in all of the text before this level about what you're supposed to do?
No.
Oh, yeah, that would be too kind.
No, it's just movie lore.
Oh.
So So yeah, so if they can get through this first stage, which we might be here for, I don't know, if I think, in my opinion, it will probably take them at least 30 minutes to probably get out of the stage, because this is probably the longest stage of the game.
Okay.
Thankfully, the next stage afterwards is sure amazing, and Temp really wants to see everybody get to that stage, because I gave Temp the password to it.
So I'm taking a look at the credits on this. Stuart Johnson, aka Stu Johnson, also worked on other classic games like Maui Mallard and Cold Shadow. Probably the good versions of that, because he also worked on Disney's Hercules, Disney's Tarzan, Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets, and also Plants vs. Zombies. But yeah, this is definitely not a great game. I like that he was, like, one of the main coders for this Neverending Story 2 game, but he also got a special thanks in it. And I'm not sure, like, if you can be one of two people working on the game, and then get thanks.
Fine! You're thankful that you're done with the game!
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Also, Kate brought up a very, very good question. That, how did Jeremy get 25 points when killing the giants is only 20 points? And the answer is, because pushing actually gives you 5 points.
Pushing gives 5 points? Each time you push, you get a point? So do you have to push them from behind?
If you push them from behind, it ends up being a total of 25 points. If you lead them into the pit, it's only 20 points. Also, you don't have to jump at them.
Oh, Smebblebear killed one! And went into the pit. Okay. Smebblebear, I'm glad that you're doing that, because that means that we may actually hear Stage 2's theme.
I'm super excited for that. I'm not excited for this purple screen that I've gotten popped up on my multi-twitch. On two people now.
See? That's why I don't use multi-twitch. Yeah! Smebble shove them. 50 points.
I don't know what people are using for multi-viewing at this point, because I'm old.
I just have individual Twitch windows opened up because...
Oh, that sounds awful.
Yeah, but it looks good. On the stream, I mean, as good as it can. Look at this.
Your stream doesn't cut out on you for half a minute at a time, so I guess you do have a point there.
Yeah. I can definitely see that these players are struggling to figure out what to do. Smebblebear has the right idea. The others will be here for a while, or possibly for the rest of the match.
It's very possible. I'm not gonna lie to you. They could get stuck.
Yeah.
A separate extension to block them. I had one, but it got broken, so.
I love that, you know, there's not a whole lot of people who worked on this there too. The other person who worked on this doing some of the audio and such for the game actually worked on a game called Necronom, and I'm just imagining that it's like a game about eating
undead cookies.
Undead cookies, yeah. Undead cookies, the Necronom. The company that made this, by the way, is Linel. They were in Switzerland, made other games such as Skate of the Art. Yeah, you heard that right. Baby Bug. They made Necronom. Traders, the intergalactic trading game, and also the Game of Life, specifically the Amiga and DOS version that came out back in 92.
As in the board game?
I'm taking a look, and... that is not the board. Oh, it's based off of the stupid Game of Life that everybody, like every coder's like, the Game of Life is the most sophisticated.
Oh, you mean the thing with the dots?
Yeah, the dot thing. Yeah, it looks like it's based off of that.
Yeah, it's Conway's game life, not the board game life.
My name's Conway. And guess what? You are now in computer science. Congratulations.
Yeah, basically.
So, I'm actually gonna let people know a little bit of the plot of Neverending Story 2, because guess what? It came out in 1990. It's over 30 years old. And I don't care about spoilers anymore. If you really care about spoilers, then I suppose don't listen to this, but yeah. Okay. So the plot, Bastion Balthazar Bux seeks to join his school swimming team, but his ability to jump off a diving board is marred by his acrophobia, or the fear of heights. He revisits Carl Conrad Coriander's antiquarian bookstore to seek advice on courage, where he rediscovers the never-ending story and hears the childlike Empress call out to him for aid.
Not again.
Bastion takes the book home, where the Orin amulet magically comes off the book cover, which Bastion takes and is summoned to Fantasia, where he meets a bird-like creature named Nimbly. And is reunited with Atreyu.
Wait, didn't Atreyu...
Sorry, I was watching Smevel.
Oh no. Didn't Atreyu, like...
Smevel was running away and then ran her right into the pit.
Didn't Atreyu go swimming? In quicksand?
I feel like I remember that.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad that Atreyu's back. Yay.
It's fine.
Novasol Droxy, thank you so much for the resubscriptions there. Yeah, Atreyu shows up in the second movie. Heck yeah. After the group encounters and escapes from giants, Bastion comes to understand that a force called emptiness is spreading across Fantasia.
Emptiness.
Oh, jeez. Oh, it's in my belly. Ah.
I know. I'm hungry. I probably am going to make a grocery store run after this, after I'm done with this game.
Okay.
I'm gonna put the stream on my phone so I can listen in the car.
Oh my gosh, all of this is so boring. Basically, everything is feeling empty, and then the force has been brought about by an evil sorceress, Zayid, or however you say it, who seeks to seize power. Zayid's inventor, Triface, develops an apparatus that strips Bastion of a memory each time he uses the Auron amulet to make a wish. Oh, that's right, and they steal the memories into bubbles. That's what it is. Okay. Nimbly was sent as a spy to persuade Bastion to make wishes until he is unable to remember why he came to Fantasia. Bastion and Atreyu seek out and capture Zayid. She seems to abandon her quest for power and agrees to lead the two to the childlike Empress. Because, you know, that totally is how bad guys work. During the travel to the Empress's castle, Zayid tricks Bastion into believing that his friends will turn against him and manages to get him to wish for a series of ridiculous wishes. Oh. It also becomes obvious to Atreyu that they are being led aimlessly. Meanwhile, Bastion's father, Barney, has noticed his son's disappearance. He finds the never-ending story in Bastion's room and sees a sticker on the front cover listing the bookstore's address. Barney rushes to Mr. Coriander, who simply tells him that he will find the answers to his son's whereabouts inside the book.
So, I know these things that are killing everybody repeatedly kind of look a little odd. They're called giants, and I'm going to put a link to what they actually looked like in the movie, because they're a little terrifying.
I mean, they look terrifying in this, too.
I mean, a little, yeah.
Yes.
But,
my gosh.
I'll just put that there.
I'm just looking through this, the plot. You know, there's not much left. And this is so boring. Basically, they go on a little walk, and this evil lady is like, I'm a jerk! Ah! And they're all like, oh, we forgot. And then it's over. Yeah, that look is a lot better than in the game. I like them.
Yeah, I mean, they're terrifying. And the second pick I put in so that you had a sense of scale on how actually big they were compared to the kid. They are. Yeah. That would be nightmare inducing. Because they're huge. And they're scary. Because, you know, that was back in the day of really cool Jim Henson stuff.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So, the guy who played the main character in the show, Jonathan Brandis, was also in Stephen King's It back in 1990. I think probably the main child. That version was terrifying to me as a kid. Also played Lucas Wolanczak in Sequest DSV. Not really familiar with that.
A lot of people remember the Sequest thing.
Like, I know.
I don't know why, because why would you remember Sequest of all things? But
I know Sequest 2021, but.
No, that's the lab.
Oh, whatever. They have plenty of quests. Shut up. Oh, he was in an episode of Murder, She Wrote. There, I know that. That's better. In the Wonder Years, Saved by the Bell, the college years, in the episode of Thanksgiving Story.
I didn't want to remember that they made a sequel to Saved by the Bell. Why'd you remind me?
Oh, I'm so sad.
Oh, it was not good.
Oh, wait, no, Atreyu isn't... Atreyu wasn't the horse.
No. Atreyu was not the horse.
Maybe he looked like a horse. But yeah, he was an actor. Played in Our House, Who's the Boss, and Growing Pains. Then what... What's the horse's name?
I don't remember.
Who is Atreyu? Is that the, like, hero?
It was the Fantasy Warrior Kid.
Oh, yeah. See, I look at Google Images when I search Atreyu, and all I see are some goth band. And I wish that was, like, what the game was all about, this goth band. Oh, by the way, Mechalink and Commander Rab have also figured out how to get points here. That's good.
Smebel's definitely quite a bit farther in the level, though.
Yep.
Even if I was going by progression for this, Smebel would definitely be ahead. But Smebel has gotten the most points by finding the most giants.
Okay.
That's why I figured this was a pretty safe way to judge. Because as soon as they figure it out, they'd probably just want to kill everything in their way. So.
Yeah.
Mm. I thought, I don't really want to try to gauge where they are in the stage because a lot of it looks the same. And it would have been a pain for us to judge. So
I completely understand that. I think that you're doing it the right way.
As soon as we get out of the stage, though, the game becomes so much more interesting. Also, I like most spots in the stage, if you push them off, they fall into a pit. But if they fall onto a ground spot, they actually just crumple into a pile. I thought that was neat.
That's a nice little touch, you know, a couple different death animations. You know, not quite as much as the kangaroo game that we saw earlier.
Oh, the kangaroo game.
Yeah, yesterday. That was great.
Before the match started yesterday, I opened that up real quick so I could play it before people did. And I was like, why did somebody make a game out of Peter Puppy's stage? Why is this happening?
Because
that was the first thing I thought of was Earthworm Jim 2, and I was like, oh no.
Yeah, so apparently the Childlike Empress actually became a producer for a lot of stuff later on. I see executive producer for The Witch, for Holy Hell, The Mars Generation. I don't know what those are. But actually won Primetime Emmy Awards for Maxima Culpa, Silence in the House of God, as well as Dov Charney's American Dream. So, yeah, the childlike producer, exactly, everybody. And she was also in one episode of Buffy, which I think is probably the pinnacle of anybody's career.
Pretty much. I mean, if you've been on Buffy.
Yeah.
Also, Kate Derby put that up.
Oh, yeah, Derby is doing pretty dang well. 145 points. Everybody is starting to learn how to play this game. It's great.
Yeah, I'm quite pleased that we have nobody stuck. We have issues, but nobody's really stuck.
I love that Falcor was in... Why is this in German? I guess for some reason the most information we have about the actor for Falcor, Donald Arthur, the voice actor, did apparently the voice of Count Duckula, various voices in The Simpsons, including Kent Brockman, did the voice of Chef in South Park. Wow.
Oh.
I love it. Yeah, Falcor is Chef, everybody.
Huh.
Well, cool.
The more you
I'm
know.
I'm pretty sure they killed him off for some really good reasons. He might have been post-Isaac Hayes or pre-
Yeah, that's what I was assuming, too. Yeah, I was assuming it was post-Isaac Hayes.
Yeah, it may have been post-Isaac Hayes. Oh, and that may have just been the German dub. Yeah, which makes sense. Actually, I'd love to hear a German dub. I don't know. It doesn't really say that he did that specific dub. Okay, he did Chef in German. He was a German I can think of a few German chefs in various media, like Seinfeld. And hopefully he was... Not like that, German chef.
I don't know. I don't know what you're thinking.
Ah.
And I don't want to know what you're thinking.
Well, I know what I'm thinking. I don't have to tell
you. I hope you knew what you were thinking.
Wait, there's a second Atreyu? Oh my gosh. There are two Atreyus. Yeah, you thought there was one. But no, it's like second Luke. It's like short Luke. Shorter Luke.
I don't know
how
to feel about this.
Yeah. He played Boxy on the original television series Battlestar Galactica as well. Yeah. How about Twisted Tales? Was in the episode Boom. Was in... Not a lot of stuff. Okay. Mork and Mindy in one episode. How about that? That was a good show.
It was a show.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Choco, you're saying the kid who played Atreyu was the lead in the first Troll film? Well, the first Troll film, I heard, is bad. But not in the same way as the second one, which is an absolute piece of art.
I remember being terrified of the first Troll film, but also it came out when I was like, oh, 5, 6, something like that. And I saw it then. I don't know why I saw that movie so early, since it was a horror movie, but I did, and I remember hiding under the blankets as a kid because of that movie.
That's awesome, Dana. Yeah, Troll 2 is amazing and also was filmed relatively close to where I live. I've gone and seen where the Goblin Queen's house is, which unfortunately partially burned down, but you can buy the burned down rubble. There. It's like $300,000 for the burned down church.
I'll pass on that one.
Yeah, but then we could turn it into a monument. Okay, a monument to crap.
It's true. You could do that. Yeah, and the two movies have nothing to do with each other.
Yeah. Well, Troll 2 doesn't even have trolls.
No, it doesn't. And wonder why they bothered with the licensing in the first place?
Well, probably because they're like, nobody is going to watch this unless we market it as a sequel. Because Troll 1 was still somehow better. Quote unquote. Somehow, quote unquote, better.
But yeah. I'll allow it.
By the way, there's this weird song in Troll 2 where all of the people stand around clapping and singing la da 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 da.
I remember that.
That song is also on Twin Peaks. And it kills me every time I hear it. Like, I was watching Twin Peaks, I'm like, I know this. And so I learned how to play it on the guitar too, just to annoy Justin.
Oh no.
Whenever I play the first three notes, he's like, no! No!
So, Smebel's actually, I'm pretty sure, fairly far in the stage. It's hard to gauge, but there are points in the stage where you actually just have to sit there following the giant.
Yeah.
It takes a while for them to walk up to a ledge, but you do actually have to go through with it.
How long can you push the giants? Only when they're right next to the ledge?
Only when they're right next to it.
That's so dumb. Okay, let me also say that
it would be really convenient.
Watching Troll 2 and Twin Peaks, it's very obvious that the people who made Troll 2 had seen Twin Peaks and were trying to take ideas from it. Like, it's kind of hilarious.
Also, I actually recognize the spot where Smebel is, and Smebel's like really far into the stage right now.
Oh, really? Well, yeah. Let me go ahead and refresh the streams real quick since we're getting a little buffering here. Maybe it'll work. Maybe it won't. Nobody knows.
I recognize the fall off to the door that they went to, and I was like, oh!
Actually, I'm taking a look, and it looks like Twin Peaks and Troll 2 essentially came out the same year.
That is kind of weird.
That's weird. Maybe they were trading notes.
Hmm.
Or maybe they just filmed Troll 2 in, like, half an hour or something. Because Twin Peaks came out in April, or started showing in April, and Troll 2 came out in October of that year.
I was just incredibly scared because I watched Smebel go through a door, and the giant was right next to them, and I was like, ah! Such a good stage this is.
Yeah, by the way, for those wondering, Twin Peaks absolutely, I feel, is a really enjoyable watch. I would recommend it. Realize that while it does have peak late 80s, early 90s type humor at some places, there are also some things that feel way ahead of its time. Like, David Lynch was pretty cool. I've only seen the original two seasons, though. I haven't seen past that.
I do actually want to watch Twin Peaks at some time.
You need to.
I know. It's one of those things that's been on my list forever of, why haven't I watched this yet? But it just never gets around to it.
Yeah, I would recommend when you get the chance. When you get the chance. And if it is something that seems like it might be interesting to you, then it will be worth the watch.
I mean, I love Deadly Premonition. That's basically just Twin Peaks right there.
You'll also probably see some things in Twin Peaks that, like, Stranger Things drew from a little bit.
Yeah,
it's so cool to see how much it, like, influenced other types of media.
It influenced so many things that you just... It was absolutely a phenomenon.
It's like the Beatles of weird, weird stuff, of like, surreal... sci-fi mystery fantasy stuff. Yeah. Anyway, I need to watch The Return. I need to watch the movie. I'll get to that possibly this year. And yeah, a lot of people make really good coffee in the show, so that's good. Smebble Bear is probably going to run out of time. I wouldn't be too surprised.
Yeah, not looking good for him.
Well, the giant just turned around. What kind of
He bumped into another giant.
I bump into people all the time, and I don't turn around.
That makes you rude.
Oh, they're rude. They're the ones who were in my way. Gotta push them to the side, stupid people in my way. Should have known I was coming. Oh no, Smebble Bear! Yeah.
So, the goal has nothing to do with the giants at all. The goal is to find a rope to the next stage. The problem is that there are a lot of giants in your way.
I just love that you can lure it over until, like, the giant is just so dumb it falls off the cliff. It's like,
I know.
I want to grab, I want to grab, I want to grab. Grab it, grab it, grab it.
I'm going to grab you, I'm going to grab you. And then, nope.
Derby Ghost is saying in Discord, by the way, that this story really doesn't end, and I kind of agree with that.
They're gonna have problems. This is why I was actually pretty concerned that no one would get to stage two, and this is, I mean, we are, what, a half, we're 33 minutes in. This is about where my predictions were. I still think Smebble has a really good chance of getting through. They seem to have gotten a hang of...
How many giants are there?
A lot.
Why?
Evil magic?
Oh, actually, yeah, if you can summon a million giants, why would you summon, like, five?
Exactly! I mean...
Especially if it's like, hey, it's either summon all of these giants or this boy may possibly topple my kingdom.
I mean, it's like money. Do you want some of the money, or do you want all of the money?
I want all of it.
Exactly.
Give me the money. Give me the buku bucks. Tempest Troll, by the way, is saying that they played for over an hour with save states in this game, never found the exit to the level.
Yeah, there's a part, and I saw Smebble get stuck in it. There's a part where the doors do kind of loop around, and
I mean,
they did get stuck there for a minute.
Door maze for ya.
It's door maze for ya.
Okay, Smebble Bear killing another giant. Haha. It's what you like to see. Didn't see a splat. I like to see that too. This game is bad.
This game's not good. I mean, I really, really hope someone gets to stage two so you can see how this game could have been better. Because it had the stages, there's two stages, like six? I think there's six stages. And none of them play the same. They are all completely different.
Yeah.
And
that's pretty impressive, yeah. Actually. Like,
I was actually pretty impressed by that part.
Is it still a platformer?
No.
Oh no. Oh, I'm scared now.
I'll spoil something. I'll spoil that one of the last stages is kind of like tubing.
Oh, you're okay. Okay, I like this game. Here's the deal. I like tubing. I just Game Boy Color tubing is not playable.
No, it isn't. It is not.
So,
but
if it comes down to being a tie that nobody beats the first stage, Smebble Bear is definitely in the lead with 1,115 points. We'll be going based off of the amount of points they score, since that essentially is directly tied to how many of the giants they have killed.
Right. I noticed, basically, they're getting a lot of mileage out of each of their death, their lives.
Oh, yeah.
So they're getting a lot of giant kills in.
Yeah, I'd say, you know, it's not it's one strategy to use one life in order to get as many points as possible and then, you know, just die and do the stage over. But I would
end Yeah.
I wouldn't want to do that. I'd want to get to the second stage.
The minute the second somebody gets to the second stage, they're in the lead.
Yes.
And all your points that you got in the first stage are just wasted. So I would not recommend point farming unless you were sure everyone else was stuck in the same stage, which you can't be. So...
Man, this is like purgatory.
I really wish... I wish that this one had the C64 music for the first stage. No. It would have made it a little more interesting, at least, to sit here and...
I just realized something about this music that makes it much more difficult to listen to now that I'm very aware of it. The bass sound that you hear, it alternates every note between the right and the left speaker.
Yes, because the Amiga stereo doesn't exist. Right.
Yeah, and I'm listening to this on headphones, and so it's just right, left, right, left,
oh,
right.
No.
Left, right, left, right. Oh my gosh, I hate this.
Bump, bump, bump. No.
Like, it was okay until I realized that. Now it just feels like an assault on my ears.
Yeah, and now you've broken Jeff. And everybody else. You have pointed this out. Now everyone else is suffering along with you.
Well, good. That's what Kusagrande is all about, making everybody sad so that I win. Oh my gosh.
You know, I played this several times. I watched the long play, and it only just noticed that the life counter is actually the little image of Fantasia falling apart.
Oh, I had no idea. Okay, that's cool.
Yeah, down in the bottom left.
So
you see how it got different pieces of it missing and people...
It's like a pie. Fantasia pie. No, Derby Ghost is very sad. And, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sorry to all of the people watching... that I have brought my curse upon you. Actually, I'm not really that sorry. Yeah, you nerds. You're enjoying watching people suffer. You get to have a little suffering every now and then. Huh? It's like a buffet. Suffering crap buffet.
Has anyone made progress? Well...
Ish.
Yes?
Points essentially reflect progress, but... Has anyone beaten the first stage? No.
Yeah.
And now, because that, the tie will be determined by the points if we do not see stage two.
There are passwords for every stage. So if somebody gets out of stage one, they don't ever have to see it again.
Oh, so that's cool. Smebble Bear, please beat the stage. I don't like this music. Like, that's the sole reason I'm cheering for you, Smebble Bear. I usually cheer for the underdog, but I'm cheering for you because I want different music.
And the second stage is so much... I'm going to be real disappointed if nobody gets there.
Well, you know what? We'll live. We've had that happen before, that we're like, oh, if only the players made it this far, and then, too bad, this is Kusagrande, we just get... sadness for the whole day. The entire day sadness. Do you have to kill every single giant?
No.
Oh.
Just the ones that are in your way.
Oh. Okay, because I interpreted your instructions as kill all of them. I hate door mazes. I hate door mazes. The one in Alien 3 is much better than this one. Or whatever alien game it is that had...
That alien door maze. Woo.
So much more enjoyable than this. At least it had trolls, you know?
The biggest flaw with this stage is that it goes on for too long.
How about the biggest flaw is that it exists...
And people
had to play this as children.
The Alien 3 door mazes were much crueler, but shorter in an odd way. there's a lot less walking involved. And a lot less waiting on giants to walk by.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, so many giants.
The timer could have stayed. I mean, they could have either made the timer longer or they could have made the stage shorter. They should have made the stage shorter. Yeah, if there had not been a timer, then we would already be in stage two. I'm just going to say that right now.
Oh, yeah. Oh my gosh, Mebblebear, you're totally going to run out of time. Oh no, Derby yep. Ghost, no, don't show this scene. That is not what we need. Everybody, F in chat for the horse.
No, no, not the horse.
There we go, better music, it's game over. Yeah, Artex. Oh, that's right, I always thought that the horse was Atreya, but it's Artex. Was this actually an arcade game originally?
No, that's just what they did back in the day.
That's so dumb.
There are so many games labeled as arcade because they were implying that it played like an arcade game. It was arcade action.
No, it didn't. How many arcade games do you play that start with a door maze? Literally none, except for this, I guess.
I mean, this wasn't an arcade game either.
Yeah, it wasn't an arcade game. What are you talking about?
Now I'm curious. Arcade games that had door mazes.
Yeah, timed door maze.
I mean, Elevator Action had a lot of doors.
Okay, but that wasn't really a maze because you just go in the door and out the same door.
Yeah.
It was like, if you think of a maze being like a leaf. Let me explain, because of the little veins on the leaf, you know, they branch out. But then you have to come back to the center again. So it's not really a maze, like, yeah.
So somebody pointed out that Mecha walked out a door and immediately got grabbed. And the thing here is that the giants keep moving after they
on a timer.
What?
They're on a global timer.
Yeah, they keep. Yeah, if you walk out of their scene, they keep moving. So if you walk back in, they might be right in front of the door that you came out.
That is so dumb.
It's really rude.
I am offended. On behalf of stupid child in the game, I am offended and upset.
Oh, we only have 15 minutes remaining? This is saddening me. Saddening me!
Not me.
I mean,
I want this music to end.
I mean, that's fair. But on the other hand, I really want to see that second stage. Really want to see it. And you really want to see it. It'll blow your mind. you'll be like, why wasn't the first stage like this?
Whatever, Dana. Just turn around, look at what you see, okay? In her face.
I didn't bump into a giant, so I'm not turning around.
Oh, okay. Make believe I'm everywhere, Dana.
Oh, that's terrifying.
Yeah. Given in the light written on the pages.
Yeah.
Is the answer to a never-ending story. Ah. I need you to reach the stars, Dana. Fly a fantasy. Dream a dream.
No.
What you see will be.
No.
I don't know. I've got nothing else to talk about this game other than, like, I hate it. I hate the music. I hate the grabby things. And I also hate the music. Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, you said the music twice.
Well, perfect.
But you really hate the music, so
I really hate
okay.
The music, yeah.
Hold on.
Rhymes that keep their secrets will unfold behind the clouds, not beneath the clouds, yeah. And there upon a rainbow is the answer to a never-ending story. Ah! Story! Ah!
I'm gonna,
do you like
I'm
my...
Gonna...
You like my interpretation of the lyrics?
I'm looking now to see if I can find the Sid Tune version of Stage 1. Because now I'm going to be like, maybe you should just hear it. We could cheat.
I mean, we could listen to it for a little bit, but then we'll go right back to this crap.
Yeah.
Oh, never any story. Let it end.
It's not going to end. It doesn't end.
I want the abridged version. I want the abridged version of the story. Oh no, Derby is saying that their cat escaped. Oh no!
That's unfortunate.
That's cats.
That is cats. So I want to point out that the C64 version of this runs at like 20 times the speed. I don't know why, but it's super fast.
Wait,
maybe I should
does
have
that
given
make,
on that one.
Does that make it enjoyable?
Yeah, you see, the first stage is done in like 2 minutes, and you're like, oh, well, okay. Maybe I should have given that one. I really flipped
Dana,
the coin.
No regrets. No regrets.
I'm just saying. I flipped a coin on this because I was like, I could have cool Sid Tunes or better graphics. People probably want to watch this and not feel like their eyes are bleeding. But now your ears are bleeding. So, sorry about that one, I guess. It's fine. Everything's fine. Everything
yeah.
is wonderful, except for the fact that they don't get to see the cool stage 2. But that's okay. Maybe next time.
Maybe next time, Gadget. Next time. Or put Stage 2 in a gauntlet.
I was about to say, in about a year from now, when everybody has forgotten this horrible thing, that's when Stage 2 strikes.
See, it's just like the movie, you know? We make a wish to see Stage 2 when we forget this game exists. It's, yeah. Okay, yeah. I'm learning how to be the stupid child in this movie. Yeah, I've learned. I think people who are playing this are having strange feelings because one of them, you know, has complained about this game a lot and is now saying, I love this game. This game is good, actually.
Uh-oh.
I'm like, no.
Stockholm Syndrome set in already.
usually that takes like a good... I don't know, a few months?
Yeah, apparently yeah. it took less than an hour.
I've got less than an hour. When this has ended, I'll either be famous or dead. That's it. That's what I've got for you.
I don't think I want that one. You can keep it.
As far as I'm aware, there's not a goofy movie game, and I'm probably happy about that. No, I know how the actual lyric ends. I'm using the Kuso version where you'll either be famous or dead. There's no choice in between.
I don't think there was a one based off of the movie, but there is a Goof Troop game.
Well, that game's amazing.
That game's good, yeah. We probably can't talk about that on this channel because that's a good game.
Okay, goofy movie video game. Yeah, Extreme Goofy Skateboarding is probably the closest one outside of that, and I've seen that, and it's a train wreck and a half. But
your
yeah,
mistake
that...
has fatal consequences.
Not again. Wait, apparently there are only like 15 extra seconds on the timer in this? That is bad.
It's not that bad.
Yes, it is. Because it takes like 5 minutes to get through, and if you only have 15 extra seconds.
No, I'm saying it's.
Oh.
Like I said, the long play had 4 pips left. So it's not 15 seconds. It's probably like a minute or two. It's kind of close cutting it, but I'm sure the long play probably took not quite the optimal path. Because it's a long play. I mean, that's kind of how that works. They didn't call it a short play. It is pretty bad still, yes. I don't like the timer.
I want to do a fat play of this. Instead of a long or short play, fat play, chubby play, tall play. Well, I'm thinking of different dimensions, okay?
You are.
Doesn't just have to be length. We can use width. We can use height. We can even go in the fourth dimension, hyper length, hyper girth.
Technically,
there
aren't
we go.
All the plays in the fourth dimension, since in the fourth dimension time, and that's kind of what we're working with here on a play. We're judging the time of the.
Da 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 da.
And meanwhile, Smebel is just saying "wee" in chat.
Wee. Yeah. Good job, Smebel. I'm glad that you're having fun. By the way, looking at Mecha Link, like Smebel Bear is definitely in the lead at this point, but Mecha Link could possibly.
I'm pretty sure Mecha second, yes.
Yeah, definitely in second. Could possibly move into first, depending on how many more giants die.
I have not kept track of the score of people as well as I should have, because I was busy watching people fail instead of watching people succeed, I guess, is the problem here.
Okay.
But I think it's Mebel Mecha Derby Rab. But I'm not sure on that.
I don't know. This game is just not good. It's not exactly
great.
No, it's
not. It gets better. But it really starts on the wrong foot. It's the first stage is honestly the worst stage. And it got to the point when I was playing it, I was like, should I give them a password to the second stage and just let them skip this one? And then I was like, no, that is not in the proper Kuso way.
It depends.
They have to suffer properly.
It depends. Like, I approve of suffering. I also approve of... sometimes. I approve of doing it the way that our game masters want to do it. And
that's
since
fair.
You wanted to make them suffer stage one, then so be it.
Yeah. The never-ending stage one.
Never-ending stage one. Oh, no. I always think of Homestar Runner whenever I hear the never-ending story, too.
I know, so
never
do I.
Never-ending
soda joke. The never-ending soda joke, when I first saw that, it killed me.
Never-ending soda.
I do always think of that one, because... It's so good.
Oh, yeah. Look, I've been trying this whole stream to not sing the Neverending Story song. I even read the lyrics without singing, okay?
And then Soda gotcha.
Well, Neverending Soda is a classic, you know?
It is. I told you, I'm seeing some people in chat saying the music was stuck in their head this entire time. And I was like, I said at the very beginning of this match that the music would get stuck in people's heads. I was right.
Oh my gosh.
They should have just looped the title music for stage one. Actually, that would drive you insane.
They should have just, like, cut stage one in half. Or, yeah.
I really wish they had. That would have made this so much more tolerable.
Well,
I don't know why stage one is so long.
Like, I'm still really glad that the people who made this went on to make better games. I imagine that when they made this, the budget was probably not exactly great, which is generally true when it comes to any type of shovelware. So the fact that they made a game that is playable, the graphics are good, and the title screen music is good, and possibly some of the other stages are good, kudos to them. However, whoever, like, gave the thumbs up to this stage being the first stage, and being okay, no, you need to apologize.
Okay. So I just dropped a screenshot of the Commodore version, the 64 version.
And you can go ahead, if you are watching, developers, send me an apology at Twitter. My name is Aprosencha. And I will be waiting all day for that apology. No, honestly, never apologize for making a game, you know. Based on how good you make the game, you know, it's either going to be successful or not. In this game, definitely nobody here has... Derby Ghost, why? I know we only have a minute left, but I don't want to cry. I don't want to cry. No, blame management. I think that is the most important thing. Whenever you get the chance, blame management, because it's almost always their fault.
It really... Like, honestly...
You've done QA. You've seen what happens.
Yeah. Like... I see where they were going with this game.
It had so much potential. Like, maybe the later stage. I want to try the later stages so that we can sort of see what comes after this. Maybe in the future we will see those, but
I'm not going to say anything, yes or no, but yeah, you might see.
Chat is asking why the horse is so damn sad. We've got 5 seconds left, so major spoilers at the hour mark. He dies! The end!
No!
No! Time! Time! Everybody, we're done! The horse is dead!
We're done, and stage one was the winner.
Oh, baby. Well, welcome to Cusa Grande, where we have to have a good laugh after all of that crap that we just had. No, browser source. Oh, no, Smebble Bear. Well, I believe that Smebble Bear took the victory today. Smebble Bear.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like you said, you were expecting that people might not get past the first stage, and indeed, that is correct. Oh my gosh.
That was a thing. That was a thing that happened.
Yeah, nobody got out of the first stage. So let me go ahead and tell you my thoughts. Actually, Stinky Turd is... what a username. Is asking about my thoughts on rocks. They're tasty. I've eaten a few rocks in my time. Don't think they really were healthy, but they look pretty good.
You probably shouldn't do that.
Depends on the rock. You can eat salt.
Oh, that's true.
Hello, Smebble
Bear. Salt is really good.
Welcome.
Hey. How's it going?
Going great. I'm really glad this game's over.
Yeah, I was thinking before today that I felt really lucky that I didn't get an Amiga platformer my first time in Cusa Grande. And right out the bat, Dana gives me one.
And
Dana.
Then that's what happens.
Dana! I love
stage
it.
Stage one is the longest stage. and it's the worst stage, and I was really hoping someone could power through it to get to the fun parts of the game.
Well,
I should probably try later.
Well, it's just that, you know, you have a timer, and this door maze, even if you know where you're going, you still get pretty close to running out of time. So, this game is the never-ending nightmare.
Yeah, the never-ending door maze.
Never-ending door maze.
You killed more giants than anybody else.
You are like Jack from the Beanstalk. Yeah, that guy.
And that's what happens in the movie, right? He just runs around for an hour, pushing guys off ears and stuff.
Somehow I think this might be better than the movie.
That's a hard choice to make, but you might be right there.
It's been a long time since I've seen the movie, but I don't recall enjoying it at all.
Well, I said before, I was excited to look up the movie after this match and see how close this made it to the, the source material. So,
and Derby just found out that you didn't have to jump into them. Derby is upset.
Oh no.
Oh no. That's what I did.
There
first
was a
time.
Standing push? Yeah.
Oh. How close was I to actually making it out of level one?
You were acting like if the timer had not gone out on you on one of your runs. You were probably like a minute or two away. There were parts that I recognized. I was like, "You're very far in the stage."
Yeah. Like
you just ran out.
Anyways, I feel like Dana. What you need to do is give them the password or whatever it is to play stage two. Because they should just play stage two on their own. I know nothing about it, but apparently it's actually good.
Like. I will do that. Give me just a moment. I'm gonna give you a password over here so you can have fun with the game.
Yeah, so Smebble Bear, I'm really happy you were able to do this. Yeah, you suffered, but at the same time, you made as much progress as you possibly could. And honestly, everybody suffered.
Yeah, I think there are far meaner Amiga platformers I could have gotten from my first match today, so I'm happy with this one.
Yeah, I mean, this one is, it's not finicky in the way that it's not, like, super difficult. It's just tedious.
It's like trailing missions in video games, where you just have to slowly follow behind a guy and hope he doesn't turn around.
Yeah.
There are several points in the long play where you do just sit there and follow behind a giant for, like, 30 seconds or more, and it's like I'm just sitting there looking and I'm like, why did they design it this way?
Yeah, I don't know. Video games were a mistake, that's all. Video games based off of movies, that was the mistake that we all made, thinking that we should play them. Well, Smebble Bear, seriously, this was a lot of fun to watch. Tell me a little bit, do you stream over at your channel? Are you playing any games lately that you like? What's the business?
I am over at the Retro Pals channel a lot, and they do rankings of mascot platformers every Friday. So I'm looking forward to giving them this game.
Where do you think it'll rank?
Share the suffering.
I think the bottom one is still Darkwing Duck for TurboGrafx-16, so it's probably better than that.
I don't know. I think I'd rather play Darkwing Duck. Like, really? I gotta be honest, yeah. I've played Darkwing Duck TurboGrafx, and I'd rather go back to it than try this out.
I am going to try this out on my own time, though. I'm excited to see if I can actually beat it.
Yeah, and definitely, I'm excited to see some of the other stages one of these days, but today is not that day. We've got to move on. We've got three more matches, Smelville Bear. Again, thank you so much. Congratulations to everybody who came and played today. And I forgot, I actually need to award points to the left side because you're on the left side. You ended up being victorious. So bam, there you go. Everybody, enjoy your channel points. So take care, Smelville Bear. Dana, thank you. Take care as well.
Thank you.
Had lots of fun.
Later.
Yay! All right, bye.
Bye.
Everybody, Casa Grande is the bad video game. Video game tournament. We have video games here. Usually, we tend to have the bad side of Kuso, but we also welcome the various types of Kuso on this channel. Occasionally, we have games that are going to be enjoyable, but absolutely strange. Will we see any of those today? Who knows? The Whittle Blue Bowie, thank you again for those gift subs. I'm going to run a quick ad as I get up and go run away for a second. I will be right back, and we will do the reveal.